The main thing that I found is finding a bird that worked with me. And I know this sounds really simple and really easy, but you have to work with your birds. It's just like if you would bring your crazy sheep in, it's gonna run away. So making sure you work with them, making sure you flip the bird over, not just the day of the showmanship. You have to work with your bird. You have to build trust. Because otherwise, that bird might go flying and running.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the Off Farm Income Podcast. Hey, thank you so much for joining us here for one of our great FFA interviews. Today is episode number 1163, and I am thrilled to have Miss Kaylee Bosma joining us from Lenox High School in Lenox, South Dakota. Did I get all that right, Kaylee?
Yep, 100%.
Well, great. Well, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
You bet. Now, I'm going to jump into information about you here in a second, but the era of Zoom, after coronavirus and all of that, which forced everybody on a Zoom, I jumped in and started doing these Zoom interviews as well. And it has been a treasure trove of riches for me because I get to look at the backgrounds of everybody that I'm interviewing. And I've got to ask you, you have one of the most interesting backgrounds behind you that I've ever seen. Is this your bedroom or something that we're in?
Yeah, this is my bedroom. Yeah, so you have Albert on the corner. He's a llama. He's my little llama friend. And then you have my bookshelf behind me, which is all full of all sorts of different treasures.
That is full of some treasures. My goodness. Now, I need something like that behind me to demonstrate my affinity for farming. But, I mean, you've got a great background there and lots of treasures. Now, I'm looking at some stuff. Is that a witch's hat on top of a globe?
Yeah, it's actually from my Halloween costume from freshman year.
Okay.
And I didn't really have a place to put it, so it kind of just got put up there.
Okay, now I've got to ask you, is there any... So, you know, you heard the term... what's the term where they hide stuff in movies that's a hint to another movie? What is that called?
Easter eggs?
Easter eggs, yes.
Are they called Easter eggs?
Yeah, Easter eggs. So I'm looking for an Easter egg here. Is there some significance about how you've got the globe turned? So you've got the globe turned, so the hat is sitting right over Asia and India. Is there any significance to that?
Not really. It's probably because when I stood up on the chair, it kept on falling off. So I just tried to find a good way to make sure it fit.
And so that's where it wound up. Well, who knows? Who knows what that means? Now, there's something else over your left shoulder. There's something kind of strung out on your wall. What is that thing that it looks like a rope or something?
Oh, yeah. It's actually like a little moss strand, and then there's little mushrooms on it.
It's moss with mushrooms on it.
Yes, yeah, not real mushrooms. I'm preparing for fall, but it stays up year round. So,
okay, so that's a fall decoration.
Yes.
Okay, moss with mushrooms. You've got to explain. So, what's going on with moss with mushrooms?
Honestly, I kind of did a little bit of like I found this kit at like I don't know it was like a craft fair or something that like you were able to make little mushrooms, and I thought it was really cool. So I found some fake ones online, and I was like, ooh, I'll buy this for my room. And then that's kind of how it ended up over there.
There. Okay, very good. And then I'm seeing some boxes. Like, it looks like matching boxes with, like, a collectible item inside of it or something.
Oh, those are my Funko Pops. I could probably go grab them, I guess. But the top one is Merida from Brave. And then you have Dumbus, Albus Dumbledore from Harry Potter. And then Hedwig underneath him. So.
Oh my goodness. Okay, this is something my daughter would like. Okay, very good. Very good. All right, so you're at home. We've got this eclectic background behind you. And is home in town? Is it out on a farm? Or is it something kind of in the middle of those two?
Yeah, I live about like a mile away from Lenox. So I live out on a little acreage.
Okay. Little acreage. And I know that you've got chickens there, right?
Yep.
Any other animals?
About, other than the few farm cats, that's all we got.
Farm cats and chickens. Okay. And I'm sorry, I cut you off. You were going to say about how many?
Oh, about, I'd have to look at my papers again, but about 250 to 300.
Whew. Okay. That's plenty of chickens.
Yeah.
Very interesting. Now, is this where you've grown up your whole life? Is this a new experience being out here on this land or what?
I've lived here my entire life. My parents, a year before I was born, actually moved down from Brookings, South Dakota to Lenox. So.
Okay.
But I've been here all my life.
Okay. Very good. All right. Mm-hmm. You are just getting ready. As a matter of fact, are you back in school yet?
I start this Wednesday.
Oh, my goodness. Okay. You start Wednesday. So by the time this airs, you'll be back in school. And so you will have started your senior year.
Mm-hmm.
And they will have handed you the keys to the school and told you that you are now in charge.
Basically, yeah.
Yeah.
I like to think so anyways.
All right. So you'll be back in school. So will this make it your fourth year of FFA or were you able to start before high school?
Yeah. I actually started my seventh grade year. So this will be my sixth year.
Wow. 6 years. So started in seventh grade. So when you begin in seventh grade, what does that look like?
It looks so at our school, we have our core classes and then we have, when I was in junior high, I guess we had two classes at the end of the day that were kind of electives.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of them would be a study hall and then another one would be your elective. And, at that time we were required to take an egg class. So in our egg class, we made things like cheese. I think we had a mini welding course at one point.
Okay.
And so it was just kind of these little fun things to get kids interested in egg for high school.
Okay. Okay, yeah. Very good. Your South Dakota accent's coming out. As you're saying ag class, I'm hearing egg class. And since your SAE involves chickens, I'm like, oh, this inspired the SAE. But you're saying ag, as in agriculture.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Very good. Hey, I went to college in Montana. You can see the flag behind me and met a lot of folks from South Dakota, North Dakota, Minnesota. So I can decipher that accent. And being from California and living in Idaho, I have no idea what I sound like. But, everybody thinks they sound normal and the other people have the accents.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, so obviously FFA has gone well. Going back into your senior year, are you going to be serving as your chapter's president this year?
I will be, yes.
Very good. And so were you just selected this spring?
Yeah, we had our chapter banquet at the end of the school year. And that's when I was selected to be chapter president.
Awesome. Now, have you served in other officer roles prior to this one?
Yes. So my junior year, I was vice president for our chapter. And then my sophomore year, I was reporter. So.
Okay. Now, why the officer team? I mean, the FFA is involved enough as it is. So why did you get involved with the officer team?
I got involved with the officer team primarily because of my former egg teacher, Mr. Wilson. He was kind of like, Kaylee, I think you'd be great at this. And I was kind of like, okay. And so then I applied for it. And I really enjoyed the people I was working with. So I just kept on doing it.
Well, so here you are, your final year of high school, final year at least of FFA there at Lenox High School and now serving as chapter president. So what's your vision for this year, how it's all going to shake out?
I really don't know. It's kind of going to be a crazy year this year. Well, I plan on going to nationals in October for my poultry proficiency to see how I do.
Okay.
So that'll be really exciting. And then right after that, we'll start our fall LDEs, which are kind of things like marketing plan and advanced communications and things like that. So then I'll move into that part of the competition year. And then starting in March, I'll do spring CDEs, which means I'll be doing nursery landscape.
Cool. Oh, nursery landscape. So, man, you've got some other stuff going on besides the chickens.
Yeah.
Very cool. Do you ever incorporate the chickens into landscaping?
Besides the occasional like yard stick-in of a chicken, not really.
Okay.
Sometimes you can, if they're free ranging, sometimes you'll get a little bit of them, but not too much.
Okay. Very good. Okay. Well, you mentioned one of your previous ag advisors. Let's acknowledge all of your FFA advisors at this point. So how many do you have at school and how many have you had over the course of your time in the FFA? Who are they?
So my former ag advisor was Mr. James Wilson. Super great guy. Loved him. He retired, I believe, my sophomore year. Yeah, he retired my sophomore year. And he worked with our second ag advisor, whose name was Jelaine Stratmeyer. Super awesome lady. She makes the best food ever. So if you ever are seeing the Lenox FFA chapter anywhere, definitely ask them about Jelaine's cooking. It's amazing. And so Jelaine has stayed with us all the way through this year, and she'll keep staying with us. And my junior year, we started with Mr. Brady Duxbury. And so now he's my egg advisor.
Very good. Well, thank you so much for acknowledging them. And I don't know if it's just the way I look on Zoom or whatever, but how did you know that food would get my attention? You know? So
I don't know. It always gets my attention too, though.
So all I've got to do is just drive over to Lenox, South Dakota, just hang around the high school, and eventually your ag advisor will cook something delicious.
Yeah, especially if you like help out with certain events, she'll bring different foods, or if you're competing.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, she makes it's good.
Very good. All right. Well, let's do this, Kaylee. I want to take a quick second, acknowledge our sponsors, and we'll be right back. Okay.
Sounds great.
Hey, everybody, just a quick break from this great interview with Kaylee Bosma to talk about our sponsors. And of course, it is an FFA interview, and I always like to kick that off talking about Lacrosse Footwear. You can find them over at lacrossefootwear.com. And I love to brag about lacrosse when we do our FFA episodes because they are so proud to support the FFA by annually sponsoring $25,000 in scholarships and jackets as part of the Give the Gift of Blue program. We, of course, use their boots right here on our farm in Cuna, Idaho, every single day of the year. I bought my very first pair of lacrosse boots, the Alpha Range, man, just about 2.5-3 years ago, well before lacrosse was ever a sponsor. And I wore those very boots this morning when I was out irrigating every single day. I've never had a pair of chore boots last longer or spread my dollar further. We want you to have the same great experience. Go on over to lacrossefootwear.com. Check out all of their chore boots, all of their rubber boots, their hip waders, their hunting boots, everything you could possibly need for your feet. Lacrosse has it, and we want you in lacrosse, everybody. And speaking of wanting you in a product, what about Powder River Livestock Handling Equipment? Tell you what, if you are going to run cattle, well, you need to get very familiar with Powder River. They have been developing the finest in livestock handling equipment for well over 80 years. Started out here in the West, actually in Baker City, Oregon, not too far from where the Off Farm Income Farm Studio is located. And then later moved to Provo, Utah, because it made it easier for them to purchase American steel. And I love that patriotic aspect of Powder River. I also love the fact that they understand that if you're going to have one cow or you're going to have 1,000, you got to have livestock handling equipment because you got to be able to treat those cows and treat them humanely. But we all run different herds. We all run a different amount of cattle through our equipment on an annual basis. And of course, that dictates our budget. And so they don't have a one size fits all. They have got equipment that is based and priced upon your usage levels. They understand small producers, they understand very large producers, and I think that has a lot to do with them developing out here in the West. So go on over to powderriver.com, check out their entire line of products, and of course, let your local farm and ranch retailer know you want to see that Powder River green out in their sales yard so you also can have the finest in livestock handling equipment. All right, well, let's get back into this interview with Kaylee Bosma. All right, well, Kaylee, now that we're back, you've alluded to your supervised agricultural experience. It involves chickens. Your business name is Kaylee's Crazy Coop. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. So tell us all about it. What does it look like today?
Yeah, so today it's kind of expanded a lot more than when I started in fifth grade. Do you mind if I tell you my story from how I got chickens? Because that's like one of my favorite stories to tell because it's so funny.
So,
do you mind?
So this is a podcast and it's all audio content. Mm-hmm. And so I never mind ever if somebody wants to tell me a story. Ooh. I always love that.
Awesome. Love it. Okay. So, so there's little fifth grade me and I go over to my friend's house and my friend's, she has chickens. And I look at these chickens like they are the holy grail of everything amazing. And I look at my parents and I was like, I want a chicken for my birthday. And they looked at me like I was absolutely insane because both my parents grew up on farms and they had like farm chickens and stuff and they hated them. But I was like really persistent. I was like, I need these chickens. So on fifth grade year rolls around on my birthday and they're like, fine, we'll get you these 30 chickens. And so I started out with these 30 chickens from TSC and they're okay. And we show them in the county fair and it goes really well. I really enjoy it. And so then as the year goes on, we start getting more involved in the showing of poultry and stuff. Mm-hmm. And so we start buying different birds. So we start buying game birds. We start buying more bantams. And it just kind of grew to what we have now. But yeah, that's one of my favorite stories to tell because I think it's so funny.
It is funny. I have I've been lucky enough to interview quite a few FFA students over the last 7+ years. And I've heard that story a few times where somebody went to their parents and said, I want this animal. I want this. I want to do this. And the parents are sitting there going, you know, I'm a parent. And so you've always got you've always got to balance. OK, what do we do to help facilitate our daughter's dream versus is she going to get bored with this in 2 weeks and we're going to be stuck with these chickens? Right. You've always got to balance those two things. You don't want to crush dreams, but you also don't want to spend a bunch of money and be stuck with something that now you have to do because your daughter, I say daughter because I have a daughter, because your daughter has lost interest. But I think in every story, well, obviously, if somebody's made it to the level that you have and I've read a story about you, I've invited you on the show. You didn't get bored. You kept going with it and it worked out. And so your parents must have been relieved.
Yeah, I mean, that first year was kind of pretty iffy because we had to buy a whole bunch of new stuff because the land that we moved on had a original poultry shed.
Okay.
But it really needed a lot of like renovating and stuff. So that kind of took a while. So they were a little skeptical when I first started. But I think I got to the point where they're pretty okay with it now.
Okay.
But yeah.
And so this started out as a project for you to actually go and show chickens. Was that through the through the 4-H?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
So it started out as a 4-H project and that was with 30 chickens at the outset. Is that right?
Yep.
Now, if you were doing it just to show, why did you buy so many chickens to start?
It kind of was a mixture between showing and kind of just getting eggs.
Okay.
Because at that point we weren't like 100% sure, like, oh, we're going to go down like the showing chickens path. It was kind of a more, my daughter really wants chickens, so I'm just going to give her some kind of thing.
Oh, so people just gave you birds?
A little bit. Sometimes they do. We don't take in like a whole lot because that can kind of get to be a lot.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Okay. And so now it has grown over the years. And did I remember this correctly that you have 250 plus chickens running around out there now?
Yeah.
Are they all free ranged?
They're not all free ranged because we're actually working on a new shed right now.
Okay.
And so we're kind of in construction mode. So we don't want to kind of hinder that.
Okay. So they're locked up. And so they've got a chicken run. And then in free range or not, whatever you want to do is fine with me. You had just mentioned that earlier. Is that one of, have you done that in the past? Is that something that is normally going on and it's just not going on now because of the construction?
It's a mixture between two different things. So we have our really fancy showbirds and then we have our more run of the stock showbirds.
Okay.
And so that's things like your Rhode Island Reds, your Barred Rocks,
okay,
and things that are typically a little bit more hardier than your fancy showbirds.
Okay.
And so typically we'll let our like hardier stock run around and eat the grass and occasionally chase a squirrel up a tree. That was the weirdest thing I've ever seen with my chickens. It was crazy. But so we typically have like two different groups and stuff. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Well, the reason I keep asking that is I'm just picturing 250 chickens just running around your place. And it just sounds like pandemonium.
Yeah.
But so that's not the way it's going. Now, you mentioned that when you really started getting into it, you got some game birds as well. So what kind of game birds did you get?
Yeah. So I believe it was about 2 or 3 years after I started with those 30 chickens. We got game bantams that originated from England.
Okay.
And so they were actually meant to be fighting birds. And then a couple years after that, I somehow convinced my parents to let me get guinea fowl.
Okay.
And so we had those birds running around for a while. But,
okay.
Yeah.
I've never thought of chickens as a game bird, but
that exists. Yeah, it's kind of crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Okay. All right. So this has all led you to being a national proficiency finalist this year, which is incredible. Congratulations. Mm-hmm. That is really, really cool. I'll be at nationals. Hopefully I'm trying to remember what day they announced the national proficiency winners on. Do you know which day of the convention it is, like Thursday or Friday or Saturday?
I think it's split up into different conventions or like the different sessions.
Different sessions.
So like A through whatever is on one day, and then whatever through like Z is on another day, but they're like split up, so they're not all at the same time.
And I'm trying to remember. So I the year before COVID, I didn't go. I went the previous 2 years. I didn't go that year, and obviously nobody went last year during COVID. The national, when you're a national proficiency finalist, I think you go up on stage, don't you? And then they pick the winner and they present the winner. So I always like to be backstage for that and for the American Star Awards. So we may get to meet. I may see you backstage. So we'll
That'd be pretty cool.
Yeah, we'll try and make that happen. That would be really, really cool. Okay, so obviously if you've reached this level, that you're a national proficiency finalist, you're possibly going to be a national proficiency winner, you have developed something extraordinary with what you're doing with your chickens. So is that a business? I know you're in the category of entrepreneurship. So are you running a business with these chickens?
Technically, yes. We sell their eggs, and we do sell birds to other counties, especially like in South Dakota, where there's a lot of small poultry counties. So man, I can't think of the counties right now.
That's okay.
Brain fart, I guess. But, so we'll sell a few to, those counties just to help get their program up and running. Because that's a big part of what I wanted, when I was younger, because when I started in Lincoln County, I think there was about there was 100 birds at the county fair each year. And that was with about 5 kids, I think. And now we've kind of expanded our county to be 200 plus birds in between 10 to 15 kids each year.
Okay.
And so I knew I enjoyed raising poultry and showing it. And so I kind of wanted to give that experience to other kids. And so that was kind of a way to do that. But yeah.
Awesome. Now, when you say selling chickens to other counties, that is confusing to me. So South Dakota can be very rural. So are you indicating that like there's one FFA chapter in each county, or when you say selling to a county, what do you mean?
Sorry, I got that way mixed up. I was referring to 4-H counties.
Okay.
So typically we'll, person that's in the 4-H county or, somebody will contact, I'm just going to use Minnehaha County because they're right next to me. We didn't sell birds to Minnehaha County. But if a person in Minnehaha County wanted birds, they would contact somebody from the state, and then the state would send it out to different people, and they would be like, are you willing to sell birds?
Okay.
And you can either say yes or you can say no. And then they kind of distribute the birds from within that county then.
So the 4-H in that county, probably through the Extension Service of South Dakota State, I would assume, they're buying certain amount of birds, 10, 15, 20 birds, and then distributing them out to their members so their members have something to show. Is that correct?
Sort of. I think I explained it a little weird, but their members will buy the birds like from the people, but the county kind of helps them get in contact with the people.
Okay. So they facilitate it. Okay. Very interesting. So you're selling birds in that way and helping other people be able to participate and have something to show in 4-H. You're also selling eggs. Now, 250 chickens, how many of these are layers for you and kind of your more hardy breeds? How many of your are your fancy show breeds?
Right. So if we're talking about like standard eggs that are about that big, about like the size, if you would buy them in the grocery store, we have about 20 or 30 of those. And so those are our really good layers. And so we typically get about 10 to 15 of those a day. But then our fancier, smaller birds, we get a lot more of those because there's a lot more. And so we'll get anywhere from like 15, 20 a day from each kind of big pen that's in there.
Okay. And so those are smaller eggs. Are your customers buying those smaller eggs? They just buy more of them?
Yes. So we put them in bigger packs. We'll put them in 18 packs. And then we'll sell them at a different price than if we sold bigger eggs.
Okay. Got it.
Yeah.
Now, is it, and I guess before I move on, is there any other aspect to your business, or is it all chicken sales, showing, and egg sales?
Just those three.
Those three. Okay. Now, showing chickens is an interesting thing. Obviously at our county fair here, we have kids that are showing chickens, and like the grand champion chicken and the reserves, they do pretty good on those. But then it kind of boils down to, as the auction goes along and things like that, it's a chicken. right? And so you don't see the same prices necessarily as you do for sheep or for cattle or something like that. But, and I talk about this all the time, but I've been to, and I follow some of these sales in Texas, and I see unbelievable prices for chickens, but it has to do with support of the FFA and 4-H and things like that. How is it for you in South Dakota in terms of showing and then auctioning off your chickens?
We haven't done that in a while. State fair was a little bit different last year for us.
Okay.
And we typically auction them off at the state fair. It kind of depends on what bird you bring and, like if you're selling it for meat or if you're selling it to be a breeding bird.
Mm-hmm.
If you're selling it for a breeding bird, those prices are typically going to be higher, like, $30 to $50, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're just selling it, for meat and you have a big bird, maybe $10, $15, that's like the max maybe.
Okay.
I'm not too good with prices since it's been a while, but.
Okay. Now, when it comes to showing chickens, have you had some success? Have you won some ribbons?
Yeah. So at county fair, I've taken the grand champion twice in a row. Yeah, this year and then last year.
Okay.
And then the last time I did showmanship at the state fair, I ended up tying for sixth place. So.
No kidding. Okay, so I want to ask your advice then for other students out there, especially if they're going to be showing chickens. What is the key? How do you not only win grand champion, but repeat and do it 2 years in a row?
Yeah. So I think the main thing that I found is finding a bird that worked with me. And I know this sounds really simple and really easy, but you have to work with your birds.
Yeah.
It's just like if you would bring your crazy sheep in, it's going to run away. So making sure you work with them, making sure you flip the bird over, not just the day of the showmanship. You have to work with your bird. You have to build trust because otherwise that bird might go flying and running. I guess another thing is being confident. Judges don't like when you're kind of quiet and soft-spoken. They want to be able to hear you.
Okay.
And having confidence in your answers really helps with that.
Yeah, that's perfect. Okay, good. So that's a good tip, to be confident, to speak loud, and I guess talk in a manner that demonstrates that you really believe and stand behind what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, with chickens, I'm assuming you do both a market class and a showmanship competition. Is that right?
Can you define what you mean by market?
So my daughter showed sheep, and she would, she would go into the show ring one time, and the judge would judge those lambs that were in there based on their marketability, like the quality of the lamb.
Oh,
and
then
another time,
I get what you mean.
And they would judge the exhibitor based on their ability to, you know, showmanship. Is it the same for you in South Dakota with chickens?
Yeah, 100%. So you, have, I guess there's about three different categories. Number one is kind of like the show chickens.
Okay.
So this is anything from your heritage Rhode Island Red, which are bigger than your laying Rhode Island Reds, and things like your fancy little bantams. Those will all go under the show chickens. And then you have your production ones, which will have egg production. So that's typically a pen of three in South Dakota.
Okay.
And then you have your meat production ones in that same production. And those are like your broilers, that I think those are pens of two and three too.
Okay.
So that's production. And then you'll have, your fowl, I guess, which are like ducks and geese and things like that.
Okay. Very good, man. Good for you. Okay. So your senior year is about to get started and are you going to grow this flock even more your senior year? You're going to stay at 250.
I'm hoping I can grow it, but I'm also leaving for college, in this next year. So I don't know how impressed my parents will be if I kind of just leave it all to them. So I might be decreasing a little bit. But
you know,
I do have two younger sisters. So.
Okay. So, and do either one of them want to kind of pick up the mantle and run with this?
They're not 100% impressed with it. They don't enjoy chores.
Okay.
But I don't think a lot of people enjoy chores. But
I love chores.
I don't know.
I love chores. Do you? What's your opinion on chores?
If I have the right music playlist and it isn't like negative 40 degrees out, I think chores are a blast.
Oh, that's right. I forgot. South Dakota's colder than Idaho. That's true. That is true.
Yeah.
And that's funny too. My daughter, when she goes out to do chores, it's a total different world. Those earbuds go in and she's got a playlist. She's listening to something, which mm-hmm. I think's nuts. I love hearing all the animals and stuff like that. I love doing chores. So maybe I'm weird. I don't know. Okay. So it's hilarious how this comes full circle. You've got that very funny story about saying you wanted chickens and getting started with this in the fifth grade and mm-hmm. your parents kind of being like, oh boy, here we go. But then bam, you took to it and you've run the project and you've grown that from those 30 chickens to 250. But now all of a sudden you're getting ready to go off to college. And so it's almost like their worst fears didn't come true at first, but now they are coming true, except you've got, 10 times more chickens than you did when they were first worried about it.
Yeah, I think I kind of hooked my dad a little bit in the poultry industry, so hopefully he'll kind of keep it up too.
Okay. Where are you going to go to college? Do you know yet?
Not really. I've kind of been looking around, not 100% sure, but.
Okay. And do you have any idea what you want to study when that day comes?
That is the most dreaded question I think all seniors dread at this point. No, I don't really know.
That is just fine. I ask that question all the time, but I don't expect anybody to have an answer. And by the way, you could pick a degree, get 4 years through it, get your bachelor's and go, well, I don't want to do this. And I understand that too. I mean, that's just the way life goes. It's hard when you're 18 or 19 or something like that to go, I'm throwing a dart at the dartboard here and whatever it lands on, that's what I'm going to do for the rest of my life. That's unrealistic. Mm-hmm. So don't feel any pressure. You do what you think you need to and you will find your way to the right thing. Do you want to continue post-college into career, family, whatever direction you take? Do you want to keep chickens as part of your life?
I think I do. This raising chickens has been a really big part of my life. And one that I've really enjoyed. I've met so many people being in the show world and just talking to people about chickens. Mm-hmm. And I really enjoy it. So I hope I can continue to do it.
Awesome. And how about running your own business? Do you enjoy that aspect? Something you want to keep doing?
Yeah, I do in some aspects. Like I really enjoy like being kind of on the front lines, like working with my chickens. But dealing with money is kind of a little bit of a headache. I'm not very good with that. So in regards to that aspect, not really a big fan of, but
now when you say dealing with money, I think what I'm hearing, you tell me if I'm right or wrong. What I'm hearing is all the record keeping, bookkeeping, accounting with it. Am I right about that?
Yeah. Like I don't mind dealing with like poultry, like record keeping, cause that's fine. I can do that any day in the week, but dealing with the financial stuff, I just look at it and I get big eyed and I'm like, I don't know what to do. So that's always kind of a crazy time. But.
Oh my goodness. You're an artist. You're a chicken artist. And I say that because you sound like an artist, somebody who wants to paint or sing or whatever that may be for a living. But in order to do that, there's got to be a business aspect of it. Otherwise, you can't pay the rent. You can't buy food or clothes or whatever. And it's like just this whole money part of it. It's just this burden that it has nothing to do with what you love. It's just this necessary evil. That's it. You sound like an artist, except you're working with chickens. So awesome. I love it, Kaylee. Well, this has been a lot of fun. Hey, best of luck to you at the National Convention with being a National Proficiency Finalist. Has there been a National Proficiency Finalist from your chapter before?
Honestly, not in the 6 years I've been in here. I'm not 100% sure, though.
Very interesting. So it could be an unbelievably...
So I guess we'll find out.
Yeah, it could be an unbelievably historical event for your chapter. Very cool. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you so much for coming on and joining me and sharing your story today.
Well, thank you for inviting me.
Everybody, thank you so much for joining us here today on the Off-Farm Income Podcast. We would love to connect with you. You can find us all over social media. We're on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and LinkedIn. And hey, if that doesn't work for you, I would be just more than happy to get an email from you. You can email me at matt@offincome.com. And you can always call me on the telephone as well.